So this is the second, so this is for her talk.
Yeah. in the same place at the same time.
All of us. Okay.
But
how do you know they have the same
class? Oh my goodness, because we're in the same place at the same time.
Always.
Reserve.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Hannaford Hall and the University of Southern Maine. For those of you that are not a faculty or a student yet, or a staff member, welcome to our community and welcome to the campus tonight. It's so great to see so many of you out here this evening. My name is Nancy Davis Griffin, and I'm the Vice President for Enrollment Management and Student Affairs here at USM. And a few months ago, I walked into my office suite, and sitting there was Lisa Walker, our director of our Women's and Gender Studies program here at USM. And she was talking to colleagues in the suite, and she was very animated. And I asked her what she was talking about. She said, "I heard this great speaker. We need to bring her to campus. She's amazing, so powerful." And we started talking, and I said, "Well, who is it?" And she said, "Loretta Ross." Thank you. So we chatted a little bit, and I said, "Well, what would it take to bring her to campus?" And we talked a little bit further, and well, here we are. You see, the reality is once she said her name, that's all I needed. Because I've worked in higher education for 36 years, and I had students and close friends that were in D.C. in 2004. And that March for Women would not have happened without the woman who is sitting on this stage. We owe a great deal to her. So I am just here to say welcome and to tell you that I'm honored to be a co-sponsor this evening and my office to be a co-sponsor of this event. And I'm humbled and honored to be in the presence of Loretta Ross. Thank you for being here.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for coming tonight. My name is Lisa Walker. I'm the director of the Women and Gender Studies program, and I'm really, really honored and excited to have Loretta Ross here tonight. I want to tell you a little bit about her. I'm sure you all already know much about her, but I will do my duty in this regard. And I also wanted to thank Nancy Griffin for sharing my enthusiasm that day and making this event possible, along with the Convocation Committee, the Intercultural and Diversity Advisory Council, and the Provost's Office. Loretta is currently a visiting associate professor at Hampshire College in Women's Studies. Yay, Hampshire. For the 2017-2018 academic year, she's teaching White Supremacy in the Age of Trump. She is a graduate of Agnes Scott College, and she holds an honorary doctorate of civil law from Arcadia University and a second honorary degree from Smith College awarded in 2013. She has written extensively on the history of African American women and reproductive justice activism, and she is the co-author of Undivided Rights, Women of Color Organized for Reproductive Justice, which was awarded the Myers Outstanding Book Award by the Gustavus Myers Center for the Study of Bigotry and Human Rights. I do want to let you know that we have some books of hers for sale in the lobby, and Loretta is happy to sign after her talk this evening. Loretta has a 4-decade-long history of social justice activism. She was one of the first African-American women to direct a rape crisis center in the 1970s, launching her career by pioneering work on violence against women. She launched the Women of Color program for the National Organization for Women in the 1980s, and she led delegations of women of color to many international conferences on women's issues and human rights. Between 1996 and 2004, she was founder and executive director of the National Center for Human Rights in Atlanta, Georgia. Before that, she was the program research director at the Center for Democratic Renewal National Anti-Klan Network, where she led projects researching hate groups and working against all forms of bigotry with universities, schools, and community groups. And she talked about her work earlier this afternoon in a workshop that I was delighted to attend, and she's just done incredible work, so impressive. She was national co-director of the April 25th, 2004 March for Women and Lives in Washington, D.C., which was the largest protest march in U.S. history with more than 1 million participants. Her talk tonight focuses on the topic of reproductive justice, a term that she and other African American women coined in 1994 following the International Conference on Population Development in Cairo, Egypt. And if you're not familiar with that term, I'm sure Loretta is going to explain it much better than I can. But briefly, this approach links sexuality, health, and human rights to social justice movements by placing reproductive health issues not only in the context of individuals' reproductive rights, which I think is traditionally how we've thought of it, but also in the larger context of the well-being and health of women, their families, and their communities. So reproductive justice... reproductive justice really seeks to integrate individual and group human rights that are particularly important to marginalized communities. Loretta's connection to these issues is personal. She describes herself as a rape survivor who was forced to raise a child born of incest, and she's also a survivor of sterilization abuse. She's really a model of how to survive and thrive despite traumas that disproportionately affect low-income women of color. She is now a nationally recognized trainer on using the transformative power of reproductive justice to build a human rights movement that includes everyone. She is the co-founder of SisterSong, a really important women of color reproductive justice collective that she founded in 1977. It organizes women of color in the reproductive justice movement. She served as the national coordinator of SisterSong from 2005 to 2012. Tonight, she's speaking on how the reproductive justice framework counters ideologies of white supremacy and male supremacy. We are so, so honored to have her here. Please join me in welcoming Loretta Ross.
Thank you. Thank y'all. That was quite an introduction. It's kind of embarrassing when people read your bio out loud and you're constantly editing in your head because you're like, oh, she didn't get that fart. She doesn't know when I messed up there. But it's quite an honor to be back in Maine. I think this is my third overall trip to Maine. I have to honestly say I'm a little pissed off. Because I never come to Maine to have a vacation. I just always come to do political work. So maybe I need to come. Yeah. I hear it's pretty nice up here if you can dodge the moose in the street. I knew I was in trouble, though, one of my visits, when instead of deer crossing signs, I saw moose crossing signs. I was like, God, get me out of here. I am so not ready to see a moose. Fortunately, I didn't see one on that trip. I'm told that if I step 10 minutes outside of town, though, I might have that joy. No. I'm here. Am I doing okay, translators, in terms of the pace? Okay. I'm a Southerner. So I quite naturally speak at a fairly slow pace. One of the things you may not know about the South is that it takes us 10 minutes to say hello. And the reason is because we're assessing whether you're worth talking to. And you thought we were just being nice. As we ask you about your family, your connections, are you churched? Only in the South do we have church as a verb. Are you church, girl? Is a frequent question. I always deflect it by saying, well, I joined the church when I was 14. And I just leave it at that. Well, I mean, I'm a professional heathen. They don't necessarily need to have that much information on me. I've heard it already from my mom. I don't need it from you, too. I was invited today to talk about reproductive justice. And generally, I start my presentations off with a bit of a bio. But I heard my bio. You heard the most important parts. I got into this work because I was pissed off, which is kind of how a lot of people are right now. Did y'all see that article that 1 in 5 Americans have participated in a protest since Trump was elected? Yeah. I'm like, rock on, man. We shouldn't take this stuff laying down. We should let them know, no, you don't speak for me, you don't represent me, and as soon as we can catch you by the short pubic hairs, we're gonna get you. Okay? And I think he's stupid enough to try to attack Mueller. Because he's a dictator. He acts like a mafia boss. I can't wait till Comey's book comes out. And you know, what's so bizarre about this historical moment is that the Republicans have moved so far to the right that the Democrats are now occupying what used to be the conservative space. You know? So we're the ones in defense of the Constitution, trying to uphold the honor of the military, trying to say democracy matters. I mean, like, wait a moment. Should we have an updated version of the Pledge of Allegiance? What are we doing here? But this is the political moment that we're in. I certainly appreciated all the women who organized the Women's March in protest, though I have to honestly say that I was a bit cynical about that, because I understood that they were marching with pink pussy hats because they were afraid of wearing red handmaid's robes. Yeah. Which works for me. Because what we're dealing with in this age of Trump is a group of people who can read the writing on the wall. They're demographically doomed, unless they can persuade white women to have a whole lot more babies. And that ain't happening. That just ain't happening. And so if you look at it through a particular lens called reproductive justice, you understand that it's very important for them to maintain power, for them to, quote, increase the number of white people in America. And there's a number of ways you can do that. Like I said, they try to persuade white women to have more babies, but if persuasion doesn't work, they're willing to outlaw birth control and abortion. Another way to make it work. By the way, I pay attention to this data. Teen pregnancy has gone down in every American population except one: young white teenagers. Reversing a 50-year trend. So if you want to know what's the logic behind their policies, look at the outcome that it's producing. Because we in the women's movement, we're trying to make sense of this. Okay, if you're against abortion, well, why are you also against birth control? Because that's the best way we know to prevent the need for abortions. And then when I saw that teen pregnancy data, I was like, oh, hell. I didn't get the memo on what the real plan was. I just thought it was a gender thing. I had not intersected the racial analysis into the impact of these policies. And so they're demographically doomed. And I enjoy saying that. So they're going to do a couple of things, I think. They're going to, like I said, increase restrictions on sexual autonomy for women to try to convince white women to have more babies. And you notice I carefully say that because they do not want more brown and black babies in America. They kill the ones we have. Okay, so this is, you have to have that analysis. Even if they do mouth off about, you know, caring for black babies and all this other stuff, don't believe it. I got a whole body of writings on the racialized attacks on abortion, where they tried to reformulate themselves as the new civil rights movement. We call bullshit, and we know better, but anyway. There's another way that they could enlarge the population, white population, proportionally. And they're also doing this. Why don't we take away the citizenship that we've already granted to non-white immigrants. They are denaturalizing people based on their race and ethnicity. Now, most of us live under the illusion that once you take the oath and you become an American citizen, that's permanent. We didn't know that it was possible to denaturalize people until the Trump administration took it on as a strategy. That you can actually just say, oh, I don't care if you've been a citizen for 32 years. We've decided that you no longer qualify. Then they have another tactic, and that's just attack democracy altogether. Because this one man, one vote stuff ain't working for them when in 30 years the majority of the voters will not be white. So let's just attack voting rights. Let's go further and call for a constitutional convention, something that has not been held in America since 1787. Let's just reopen the Constitution. And while we're at it, and Republicans are controlling 32 or 34 state legislatures, let's just repeal the 14th Amendment that grants citizenship to African Americans and people who are born here, the birthright citizens. Oh, and let's repeal the 6th Amendment that demands, Article 6 of the Constitution, not an amendment, the Article 6, that demands that when the United States signs a treaty, it's the same as if the Congress has passed the new law. Well, we don't actually mean those treaties anymore, so let's repeal those. You know, why should anybody trust America's word when we can just rule by fiat? And while we're at it, let's declare that life begins at conception. So now we gotta have birthday parties for every sperm. I guess masturbation will be child abuse. I'm willing to take it that far. If you go there, I'll go there. And so this is what they're doing. I think 23 states led by Republicans have already voted for a constitutional convention. What really concerns me is that there are people on the left so naive that they think that they should join the call for a constitutional convention, as if we had the power to stop these bozos from totally pushing us out of the Constitution. Because they want to define citizenship not only based on who you are, but who you marry, who you have sex with, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So what makes us think we would win that struggle when we can't even keep Trump out of the damn White House? I mean, you know, that's a really low bar, and we failed. You know, that's not what you call an Olympic hurdle. Keep the dumbest MF in the world from becoming president. But a lot of people on the left seem to think that the best way to address Citizens United and the dark money in elections is to have a constitutional convention. And I'm like, what planet are you on? You would only propose that because you're pretty much guaranteed to be insulated from the consequences of your magical thinking. The rest of us aren't. And stuff. So, this is a peculiar time. Oh, I will continue talking about what else they're going to do. Because I love talking about white supremacy, I really do. I've been doing anti-fascist work since the mid-1990s, and those of us who did this work, we felt like Chicken Little running around saying, the sky is falling, the sky is falling, and nobody believed us, that the fascists hadn't retreated, they were just regrouping. And it was so hard to get anybody to not only believe us, but you couldn't even get the mainstream media to say the phrase white supremacy, because they thought we were overreacting and stuff. And then the sky fell on November 2016. And all of a sudden, people who couldn't say the phrase white supremacy suddenly are manufacturing themselves as experts on it. I don't care what time you woke up. That's a matter of indifference to me. I'm glad you're woke. But don't come from that position of not being woke a year and a half ago and tell people of color how to struggle against white supremacy. Okay? And don't so embrace your toxic, your other marginalized identities to hide yourself from the toxicity of white supremacy. One of the most common tactics is when we start talking about white supremacy, somebody will say, Well, what about? I'm like, yeah, right. And what about how difficult it is for you to stay on a conversation around white supremacy without exhibiting white fragility? The lack of racial stamina. And let me just stop and say, white supremacy is a body of ideas. It's not a race of people. It's a toxic, noxious set of ideas about power and domination, which includes racism and misogyny and Christian nationalism and transphobia, homophobia, all the isms we all know about. So you can't just work on one aspect of white supremacy. You've got to work on it all to understand it. And so obviously, everybody who's white is not a white supremacist. But the most surprising things to most people is that everybody who's a white supremacist is not white. Think of Ben Carson, Clarence Thomas. They are making a lot of people of color rich by supporting the ideas of white supremacy and stuff. What was that unfortunate child, Omarosa? It's hard to feel sorry for her. I try to call on my higher self. I find it inaccessible for her. You know, I'm one of those people that's like, girlfriend, you should have just become a sex worker. You should have, at least that's a renewable resource. Your integrity is not. You sell that once, it's a deal. You don't have that anymore. There are so much other things you could have sold and still had it. I'm just saying. So, one of the other things that they probably will do, because they're demographically doomed, is elasticize the definition of whiteness. Just like the Irish used to not be considered white, and Jews used to not be considered white, I think that they're going to create new categories of off-white. A little beige. Where high-income earning East Asians will be included. High-income Middle Easterners will be included. White-passing Latinas and Native Americans may be included. And probably a few white-passing Black people, too. But whiteness has always defined itself in opposition to Blackness, so, you know, at best, we'll be, you know, cafe au lait or something. We're not going to get the white off-white thing and stuff. And so they're going to expand the definition of whiteness provisionally. And so what I try to caution my friends who think they can pass is, remember the lesson from Jewish people who thought through assimilation they'd never see a march in Charlottesville, Virginia, with people chanting, "Jews shall not replace us." because they thought that was over with World War II. These people practiced the most ruthless blood politics you've ever seen and stuff. And so even if they're willing to use you, as soon as they wipe out everybody else, they're coming after you. Because that's the way they work. I wish they were more original. No, I don't, because my work would be harder. Because a lot of people don't even know where white supremacy comes from. And so let me go there and then go back to reproductive justice, which is why you brought me here, I think. Anyway. You don't want to tell a professional talker to keep going, honey. I can give a speech to make Fidel Castro take a breath. You kind of have to know how he would give those three-hour orations to the Cuban people to get that joke. Anyway, where was I going? See, I lost my train of thought. Origins of white supremacy, that's right. Because I teach this class, I try to get people to understand where the whole concept of a master race came from. And you have to start not with the enslavement and the American colonies, but you have to back it up well 400 years, maybe 300 or 400 years earlier, and go to the Iberian Peninsula, that part of Europe that Spain and Portugal occupied. And for years, Portugal felt itself subordinated to Spain. They had tried to go to war with them to dominate the peninsula because Spain enjoyed the trans-Saharan trade route. I get confused the way that Europeans partition Africa, but anyway, moving right on. The Trans-Saharan trade route that was dominated by Africans and Arabs. And so they couldn't fight Spain militarily and win, but they were afraid that they would eventually be conquered and absorbed by Spain. That's where they were. So what they decided to do was send a ship west around Africa's coastline and see if they could develop a different route for obtaining the goods, the wealth and stuff that they were getting from the Middle East and Africa. But when they got to those African coastlines, they saw a lot of trade centers established, but they didn't see any military defenses. And so that ship that the Portuguese sent out decided, instead of establishing trade relationships, let's just conquer them and take it. Now, these trade relationships have been going on for thousands of years. One country decided to change everything. So they used the military that wasn't successful against Spain against Africa. And what they then did was redefine their entire relationship to their African former trade partners. All of a sudden, the Africans went from being kings and queens and civilizations to beasts that needed to be conquered, who didn't know how to responsibly manage their own natural resources. The whole conquest philosophy was articulated by Portugal. Of course, once Portugal did that, then Spain saw it, then England saw it, then France saw it, then Holland saw it, and then next thing we know, we got a whole colonization project going on, raping Africa and the Middle East and stuff. Now, I said I was going to tie this to white supremacy. Up until that fateful decision, Portuguese were called Portuguese. Spanish were called Spanish. Right? You know, they were identified by their nations, or nation states at the time. They're emerging nations. But the first thing they did was not only change their relationship with Africa, but they changed their relationship with people they defined as the other on the Iberian Peninsula. So that the Moors, who had successfully colonized and in many ways, populated Spain, started getting expelled. Muslims, instead of being defined as a different religion, began to be defined as a different race. Jews, instead of being defined as a different religion, began to be defined as a different race. And everybody who wasn't Muslim or Jewish was defined as a white Christian. That's why I say you have to have Christian nationalism into this definition of white supremacy. And then they wrapped religious justifications for changing their economic relationships, which is what they do. I was in Africa once, and this African quipped to me, when the white man came to Africa, we had the land and they had the Bible. But by the time the white man left, he had the land and we had the Bible. That's the way it goes. So the first time Jews were ordered to wear badges indicating they were Jews was in the Iberian Peninsula, because they couldn't distinguish white Christians from white Jews. This was 300 years before Hitler, before the first pogroms against the Jews. Pogroms where they riot and destroy a community happened because of this change. And by the way, it is not coincidence that the pogroms against the Jews seem to always happen in communities where the white Christian owed the Jewish bankers money. Well, you kill the holders of the debt, you wipe out the debt. So you don't have to search hard to find the logic of what we're seeing today. You just have to start at a different historical moment than Columbus. Okay? And once Spain consolidated its control of the Iberian Peninsula, that's when they were able to send their ships off to the New World and continue the process. Stealing, rape, plunder, and now we're into plunder capitalism, and this is what we do. But I'm telling you this story to say that I believe things that can be decided a different way. You know, there's nothing natural about plundering other people's stuff. There's nothing inevitable about that. That's a decision people are making every day and stuff. And so I'm an activist because I believe that humanity is capable of making different decisions. I really do believe that. So, this is the kind of conversation I have with my students at Hampshire College. I've got the children of the 1% learning how to deconstruct white supremacy, and we're having a ball. I do want to say, just to conclude this section though, that their first immediate reaction is to be pissed off, because they question why this information was withheld from them all their lives. You know, why this racial innocence was created in them till somebody slaps them in the face with the reality of what's it like to be white in America from some other perspective than the white one and stuff. I think it's bad parenting. I really do. I think white people are taught to be adverse to conversations about race and racism. So that even if a child points out that a person is of a different race, we tell them that's rude. They're not supposed to notice. They're not supposed to say anything. So we create this cognitive dissonance in our own children where they see something, but they can't say nothing, because it's verboten. Really? we keep our children racially and sexually immature. And it's not helping. It's not working out very well. So to the young people in the audience who haven't made the decision whether or not to be a parent yet, think about how you want to parent differently so that you don't end up sending a child out as emotionally underdeveloped as maybe your parents did. Yeah. Because it's that magic age of 18, you're supposed to know everything. And a whole lot of 18-year-olds spend all their time pretending that they know everything because they know exactly what they don't know. And, you know, so that just goes on and on and on. Okay, let's get to reproductive justice. I give you this context, though, to talk about why I'm so passionate about this. Because I think all politics are reproductive politics. Every empire needs bodies. You know, they need bodies for wealth creation, they need bodies for armies, they need bodies for labor. And reproductive justice simply explains whose bodies are reproductively privileged and whose bodies are reproductively disadvantaged and why. It's really simple. And my critique of my women's movement is that we don't use a broad enough lens to understand the reproductive politics of the day because we think it's only about abortion. Right. You know? And it's way beyond abortion, y'all. Abortion is just a wedge issue to talk about power and domination by a select group of people. And if you can't broaden that analysis, you're trying to figure out what's going on because you're constantly reacting to a plan that they started 50 years ago. Oh, by the way, speaking of 50 years ago, there's a wonderful book by an author named Nancy McLean, Democracy in Chains. Anybody read that book? Oh, my God. She's a historian at Duke University who stumbled upon this archival treasure trove of why the Koch brothers are doing what they're doing to deconstruct our democracy. So I totally recommend it. It's called Democracy in Chains by Nancy McLean. This book is so powerful. Let me just tell you this story. My grandson is totally STEM. He's a computer-assisted design engineer. So he's kind of like my son. Both of them, you know, don't recognize anything dealing with politics, humanities, or anything because they're too busy into math and science. My son was surprised when I went to South Africa when Nelson Mandela got elected because he said, "Mama, why did you go to South Africa in the first place?" And I had to remind myself that my son in 1994 was probably the only black person in the world that didn't know Nelson Mandela just got elected president. I mean, that's how disconnected and immersed into their engineering that they are. So anyway, let me bring this back. My grandson called me about 3 months ago. And he said, Grandma, you're political. Yeah. Yeah, baby, where are you going with this? He says, have you heard of this book called Democracy? And he kept saying, democracy. And he said something about democracy and being fettered. And he was trying to describe it. I said, are you talking about democracy in chains, honey? He said, yeah, that's it. Can you get me a copy, Grandma? Oh, it was one of those sublime grandma moments. Something had penetrated. I don't know where he heard this conversation, because we don't talk about politics. You know, we grandson, that's what we do. Matter of fact, it took, you know, 15 years to get his face up. You know, because he was that kid that after he turned 10, this is all he ever did. You know, so I kind of lost sight of my grandson into a cell phone. And so I'm just telling you the reach and power of this book to explain the deconstruction of democracy that's taking place right now. Because I feel if it's reaching down into that obscure world of my grandson, we all should be reading this book. You know? Don't read the Comey memoir. Read this. So moving right along. Because all empires need bodies, what reproductive justice does is explain three basic tenets. And we black women came up with this in 1994. Our first tenet is the right not to have a child. And we join with the pro-choice movement in fighting for the right not to have a child. So we use birth control, abortion, abstinence, if you can hold on. I mean, some people say it works. I don't know. I've never abstained from anything I wanted to do, so I don't know. Ask me about the 60s, I'll tell you. Which is kind of funny. I have a lot of fun with young people who think that they're the first group of people who wanted to be sexually freaky. We're the generation that decided our sexuality based on who was cute. Well, moving right along. But I mean, really, I'm having all these crazy conversations with young people about polyamory. The right to screw whoever you want to screw when you want to screw them. That is not an original conversation, trust me. That conversation originated with the invention of sex. I'm just saying. Anyway, so we share an agenda with the pro-choice movement about birth control and abortion. But because reproductive justice was created by African American women in particular, we have to fight for the right to have the children that we want to have. So that's the second tenet. We have to resist eugenics, population control. Have y'all seen all the latest work around that's been done around black maternal mortality? How black women are dying in childbirth at rates of the. So fighting for the right to use midwives and doulas and to resist unnecessary cesarean sections and medical interventions and stuff like that, that's equally as valuable to us as fighting for the right not to have a child. And then the third tenet of reproductive justice is also born out of our lived experience as black mothers, and that's the right to see our children raised in safe and healthy environments. So that brings us into conversation with the Black Lives Matter movement, environmental injustices. Did y'all see the state of Michigan has withdrawn the water supplies from Flint, saying the crisis is over? The people of Flint don't even have clean drinking water for their children. But somebody's decided that the man-made crisis is now over. So when you talk about the right to raise your children in a safe and healthy environment, we don't use the same definition white people use, because white people use good to mean absence of people of color. You know, good school, good neighborhood, good politics, absence of people of color. Where we're talking about the right for our children to have a quality education, or the right to have tax policies that make sense so that teachers don't have to go on strike to get paid while billionaires get tax breaks. They're trying to pit the young people against the teachers, saying, well, you know, if we weren't paying all this money into Social Security, we have enough money to pay teachers. That's bullshit, y'all. Yeah, they're always pitting the most vulnerable groups against each other so that the people at the top can maintain control. That is not an original strategy either. I'm convinced that the way white supremacy was contoured in America was to protect the power of property-owning white men by recruiting non-property white men to be against everybody else. And that's the way it works.
And then when these white men who find that they are failed patriarchs because they're not wealthy and rich and able to get away with everything that they think they're entitled to, when they finally figure that out, what do? They get a gun and become murderers. And stuff. Why isn't everybody talking about the gender imbalance of mass murderers and the racial imbalance of mass murderers in this country? I mean, really? It ain't that hard to figure out. These are not just mentally disturbed people. What's mentally disturbed is the toxic masculinity that calls itself America. That's what's mentally disturbed. But the right to have a child, the right not to have a child, the right to parent your children. That's reproductive justice. Easy to say, hard to achieve. And that's where we are. We also pivoted away from using the U.S. Constitution as our basis, because the U.S. Constitution is a woefully inadequate document for protecting people's human rights. I think some of you may notice that women still aren't in the Constitution. There's yet to be an ERA, an Equal Rights Amendment, writing women into the Constitution. And of course, like I said, only black people are added with the 14th Amendment, and we keep adding, and now they'll use the 14th Amendment to protect the rights of corporations and not people. So, I mean, this slaveholder document will never be sufficiently amended as far as I'm concerned. Because at its core, it elevates property rights over human rights. It was designed to do that, and that's what it does very well. Just pisses the rest of us off. And so we pivoted and sought another legal and moral framework. And we were lucky to find this in the Global South, because feminists around the world were using the human rights framework with which to make the claims that we were putting into reproductive justice. And I remember being pretty much astonished when I found that out, like in the mid-1990s, that we have civil rights, economic rights, social rights, cultural rights, political rights, environmental, developmental, and sexual human rights. I don't have time to go through all of those, but I've got a gazillion YouTube videos you can watch if you want a full human rights education class. So that's when I went off in 1995 and founded the National Center for Human Rights Education. Because in my analysis, you can't fight for rights you don't know you have. And very intentionally, human rights is kept out of our educational process. Because, I mean, it's kind of logical that they don't teach you about human rights. Because if you teach people that education is a human right, then how could you get away with charging them hundreds of thousands of dollars that they should be getting for free? Our whole educational system is based on violating people's human rights. And so that's one of the reasons it's not in our pedagogical approaches. And I think the most radical thing you can do, whatever discipline you teach, is to base it on the human rights framework. Break that cloak of silence about human rights. And by the way, I named 8 categories. But I think there's a nice category of human rights that is very appropriate right now, and it's going to be called digital human rights. And we see what's happening with Facebook and the invasion of privacy and things like that, that if we don't start seeing our privacy as a human rights issue, we're going to be way behind in catching up and protecting ourselves. And so when we rested reproductive justice on the human rights framework that people were successfully using. Oh, by the way, let me just tell this story. How did I learn about human rights? Of course, like most Americans, I heard the phrase all my life. But I always thought of it as like a tortured prisoner in a Chinese jail somewhere, because that was the impression that had been created by the traditional human rights organizations like Amnesty and Human Rights Watch. They always were calling on us to write letters to free this political dissident, or da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And it wasn't until I did my anti-Klan work that my boss at the time was Reverend C.T. Vivian, who had been the aide to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who's quite a famous man. I think a lot of people don't know him because he wasn't assassinated. But he started the whole sit-in protest in the 1950s in, of all places, Peoria, Illinois, where he was. You know, I think the sit-ins was happening down south. The first sit-in was actually in Illinois. Anyway, he was my boss, and he was the one that told me that Dr. King never meant to be a human rights activist, I mean a civil rights activist. And I was like, what you talking about? Because down south, we're taught to say Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, civil rights activist, like this is all his name. You can't leave any of it out without being disrespectful. And so when Reverend Vivian told me he didn't really want to be a civil rights activist, he wanted to be a human rights activist, it was like, boom. And of course, I didn't believe him. I have a tendency not to believe ministers, so forgive me, God. But your people have been known to lie. Anyway. And so Reverend Vivian went and got from his library shelf a copy of Dr. King's last Sunday sermon, March 31st, 1968, 4 days before he was assassinated. And Dr. King talked about us being in the middle of a triple revolution, a revolution in weaponry with our ability to destroy the planet many times over. Of course, he was talking about the atomic bomb, nuclear weapons. And he said the second revolution is the revolution in communications. And isn't it marvelous that we can communicate around the world instantaneously? Now, he was just talking about the telephone. I know he'd be aghast at the internet. But he was right. There was a communications revolution that was taking off in the 1960s. But he said the third revolution is perhaps the most important. He said there's a freedom explosion called human rights taking place around the world. And this is perhaps the most important revolution. And 4 days later, of course, he was assassinated. And so when Reverend Vivian told me this, I have to honestly say I was pissed off, because everybody told me Dr. King had a dream. Nobody told me he had a plan. That we were supposed to be building a human rights movement. That I should be part of the women's rights wing of the human rights movement, working with the workers' rights wing of the human rights movement and the anti-racist wing of the human rights movement, and on and on. We've been organizing in silos based on identities instead of organizing based on our shared humanity with intersectional identities. There's a different way of framing it. Maybe I can clarify it this way. Would you agree that every child should have a human right to an education? Or would you also agree that a deaf child should also have interpreters? What that means is that person doesn't have special rights, they have special needs that have to be attended to for them to have the same human rights that other people have. And that's how you use intersectionality. It's not just a statement of your identity, it's a statement of your oppressions. What disadvantages you from enjoying the same human rights as someone without those disadvantages enjoy? People are so misusing identity politics. Oh, I'm this, I'm that, I'm that. Like, yeah, get over yourself. Every human being has identities. That don't make you special. And the fact that you got to brag on it just tells me you're an amateur. I mean, really? I kind of celebrate your identity declarations the same way I celebrate that you know how to tie your shoes. I'm glad you know. But probably we peeped those identities about you before you knew. Yeah? It's not what you're born. It's not what your identity is. It's not who you love. It's not what's in your pants. It's not what's on your skin. It's what you do. It's what's in your head and your heart that matters. That's what I'm going to pay attention to. And so for me, the world is a binary. I know binaries are bad. But the binary that I'm very comfortable with is I'm building a U.S.-based human rights movement. And I define as my opponent everybody who's against that. It's very simple. Yeah. I don't care if the system is capitalism, communism, communalism, or barter and trade. If it does not protect people's human rights, it's a failed system, in my opinion. So no, I'm not going to join all my Marxist buddies and talk about, you know, the evils of neoliberal capitalism and blah, 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 which is evil, but, you know, so was, you know, the conquest and trade relationship of the 11th century. So, right. That's how some folks do things. But my point isn't what was done in the past. My point is, what are we going to do going forward? And one of the things I'm convinced of is that reproductive justice is a pathway forward for us to really reinterrogate all of the past relationships, all the news we've been told, all of that. Now, one of the things I like about reproductive justice is its implicit universality. Because it's based on the human rights framework and everybody has the same human rights, even though it was created by Black women, it doesn't only apply to Black women. Everybody should have the sexual autonomy and the sexual freedom to decide if and when they'll have sex, if and when they'll have children, how they raise and parent their children, assuming you're going to do it in safe and sane ways, because there's a lot of crazy-ass parents out here, too, who violate the human rights of their children, because they don't understand. Young people are just little holders of human rights. They got the same human rights. They're no less human just because they haven't turned 18. You know, I mean, get over that. And so it has that universal appeal because everybody can use their own intersectional identity to determine what they need from reproductive justice and human rights. I remember when I worked at NAP, I should start shutting up. Somebody give me a time check because I can run on. Anybody's bladder full? Anyway. When I worked at NOW, I worked for a wonderful woman named Eleanor Smeal. She was one of the presidents I worked for. And Alice Cohan, by the way, I need to bring her into this conversation. Alice Cohan was the director of all the NOW marches. I was just her co-conspirator. So do not ascribe to me what Alice did. She brought me in because they were having too many fights. And the fights they were having was when they called for the 2004 march, a whole bunch of women of color said, oh no, not again. Here go white women planning something without us, da-da-da, da-da-da, da-da-da. And in the midst of this rebellion in the ranks, NOW and the other leading women's organizations were taking on the Bush administration. And so it was a smart strategic move to bring me in as the leader of SisterSong to help organize the women of color to participate in the March for Women's Lives. At least they could not fight on that front while they were taking on the Bush administration. And by the way, their collaborators in the march. Because what was different about that 2004 march was the first time NOW had ever organized a march in partnership with other organizations. You know, usually it was NOW putting up the $5 million and then other people guys got to march. This time, NARAL, Planned Parenthood, Feminist Majority, and NOW were partnered. So they were already having stresses about needing to work together. Because, you know, it was kind of funny, actually, to an outsider. Because I remember sitting in one meeting, and the groups with the deepest pockets were trying to produce enough signs to brand the march the color they wanted it to be so that they could claim the march. So, of course, Planned Parenthood had pink, NARAL had purple. You know, NOW didn't have the money, so, you know, they were like, oh my God, look at these people. You know, ain't never organized a march in their lives, yet they're trying to brand it. And we as women of color, we had our little purple and gold signs and stuff. But the funniest thing I heard in that meeting was a woman from the ACLU, because the ACLU had been brought on as a march partner. And the woman from the ACLU said, oh, is this about how many signs we can produce? Well, we can produce a couple of million. How many would y'all like to see? And ours will be blue. Such is power politics in Washington, right? And we couldn't get enough money for porta potties, but the people had enough money to print their pink, purple, and blue signs to brand the march. And this is us working together. No wonder we're so challenged. Oh, I forgot where I was going next, because I divert myself. I'd like to say, you know, it's early Alzheimer's, but I think it was because I had so much fun in the 60s. There are whole portions of my life I just don't remember. But I know I had a good time. I had a really good time, which is also makes people's pursuit of pleasure nowadays appear so quaint and stuff. But anyway, back to reproductive justice. I think it's a way to organize people to participate in the human rights movement. What's kind of surprising about it for us as the Black women who created it, we created it for a very specific purpose, which was to criticize the attempt by Hillary and Bill Clinton to do health care reform without including reproductive health care. That's what they were doing in 94. And that pissed us off, because we're like, reproductive health care is the number one reason women go to doctors. I mean, your first on becoming a woman moment is those feet up in those stirrups. And you're praying that they warm the speculum. You know? And so, for the Democratic Party to imagine that they could omit reproductive health care and slide health care reform by the Republicans was the first of many attempts they keep doing over and over again to throw women under the bus. Because they keep doing it over and over and over again. President Obama, we're not going to repeal Hyde in the Affordable Care Act. Abortion. He even concretized the abortion restrictions. And I swear, when we met with President Obama and he told us that, I unfortunately had a bad response that ended my invitations to the White House. Because a reporter overheard me telling somebody else, and it was a reporter for the Washington Times, the Mooney paper. Anyway, I said, you know, President Obama is like my prom date last night who doesn't remember my name today. How can you throw Black women under the bus when we are the most loyal voting constituent of the Democratic Party? What the fuck? Y'all saw what happened in Alabama. Y'all saw what happened in Virginia. If there is a blue wave, black women are leading it. Because white folks are too confused. So they throw us under the bus in pursuit of the angry white male they'll never get back. Because they're too caught up in being angry, white, and male. If you decide on how to vote based on how somebody pees, you're not ready. You're not ready. You know? And so, anyway, that's how we started Reproductive Justice, was to protest omitting reproductive health care from health care reform. We were surprised when it launched the way it did. We knew it worked for us as black women, and then when we decided to use it as our organizing principle within SisterSong, which was founded in 1997, 3 years later, it worked to organize women of color. What we weren't prepared for is how it shifted the debate to the left within the entire pro-choice movement. We actually, that was one of those unintended consequences. A lot of people like to say that we created reproductive justice because we were angry at white women. And that is a point of view. It's not a correct one, but it's a point of view. I mean, yeah, we're angry at white women, but those two things are not related. We can be angry at white women, but that's not the point. What that narrative says, though, is that when the 12 of us were in Chicago talking about what we needed from healthcare reform, instead of putting ourselves in the center of the lens, we put white women. And that's not what we did. We said, what do black women need from healthcare reform? We need this, 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 this. That's where reproductive justice was born. That it had the unintended consequence of throwing the pro-choice, pro-life paralysis into sharp relief. It just happened to do that. And what happened was that a lot of the more progressive, radical wing of the pro-choice movement started gravitating towards the reproductive justice framework, because it more fully articulated what they wanted: the right to have a child, the right to sexual autonomy, the right to sexual freedom, the right to sex as a human right. Oh my God, ooh la la. I mean, we became the pro-sex wing of the pro-choice movement. Which, by the way, let me just stop and say, I'm always stopping myself and forgetting where I was, but y'all are very forgiving. I wrote an editorial or a book review of Katha Pollitt's book, A Pro, because she wrote a book about pro-choice politics. And in it, I love Katha's book, but I was like, if we had organized ourselves not as a pro-choice movement, but as a pro-sex movement, up against these anti-sex hypocrites, we would be so much further along, because there are so many more people who want to have sex than who don't want to have sex. Even the ones that can't still want to. I mean, the whole debate would have shifted. But it was possibly our inability to come up out of our respectability politics and talk about the human right to sex and sexuality that just got us talking about choice. A marketplace concept, if there ever was one. And stuff. And so when women of color offered this pro-sex place, all of a sudden SisterSong became the place where everybody was gravitating to. One of the funniest things happened to me while I was leading SisterSong was at our first national conference. We used to organize based on ethnicity. So we had an African-American caucus, a Latina caucus, Asian Pacific Islander, and Native American caucus. That's how we organized according to our ethnic groups. We used to call them mini communities. And our first national conference, after I had split everybody up into caucuses, I looked around and there were 50 white women still in the room. And I went, oh shit, I hadn't thought about y'all. because they had been drawn to Sister Song and the radical analysis that we were offering. And so it was at that moment that we opened up our membership ranks, and now everybody can join Sister Song. I invite all of you to do so. Then we invited men in, and next thing I know, Sister Song became the radical place to be if you wanted to talk about reproductive politics, with a critique of neoliberalism and white supremacy thrown in and stuff. So, and every couple of years we have a wonderful conference called Let's Talk About Sex, Baby. Like I said, we have fun with this stuff. Our most recent one was in New Orleans last fall and stuff, and we're probably organizing another one. I'm no longer in the leadership of Sister Song. I actually retired in 2012. This is what retirement looks like for an old girl. But since I don't do daily activism anymore, I've chosen to write books and give lectures and teach, kind of like a brain dump kind of thing, for 50 years worth of work. And I'm really happy to do that, and thank y'all for listening to me this evening. Y'all are too easy. I'm told there's a little time for questions. Can you help me identify?
Aisle, if you would like to approach the mic with a question, that would be great.
Yes, line up at the microphone. I see one right there. Where's the second
one? There's one on the left there also.
Okay. I don't have my glasses on, so I can't see. I lost my glasses somehow in traveling today. So. Okay, I explained everything so beautifully, you have no questions, right?
Well, hi. Thank you. I'm a little nervous.
That's all right, so am I, but it doesn't show.
I thank you for the talk. I really enjoyed it, and I like a lot of your perspective. And I wonder what your thoughts are on the term racism and race and racial, because I think that, personally, I think that those terms do a lot to divide us rather than bring us together. We're all one race.
Okay.
And I mean, that's not discounting the fact that I'm very much aware that we have discrimination and skin color and every other kind of...
I think I got your question.
Yeah,
you don't have to explain anymore. I got your question. We are all one race. DNA proves it every day. Life originated in Africa. The funniest thing in the world is to see white supremacists get DNA tests. And they suddenly get niggerized and like, oh shit. You know? So yeah, there is that. But unfortunately, we live in a society where the politics of power and domination requires dividing people and putting one set of people on top and holding another set of people back. That's the reality of what we live. So you got the reality of the science and the reality of the politics, and they are not the same thing. So you can't respond to the political argument with just a scientific definition that we are all one race, because then you're ignoring the harms of the political project. Does that make sense? You know, so if you ask a question, white people are most often uncomfortable with discussions of race because what that demands is the recognition that you have been raced, right? And it is much more comfortable not to think of yourself as a raced human being if you're white, where people of color have no choice because we get raced by simply our mere existence. And so, it is not unusual for white people to not lean into that discomfort, but want to let's say we, the best way to get rid of racism is to get rid of racial categories. Unfortunately, that's not a useful strategy. White supremacy was created by white people. It's going to have to be deconstructed by white people, but it can't be deconstructed by being ignored. Now, the other thing your question makes me want to speak to is how useless it is to call someone a racist. I have deprogrammed white supremacists. I have talked to people standing up there in their Klan robes, and the first thing out of their mouths is, "I'm not a racist, but." So the weaponizing of the term racist is one of those things that we're going to have a lot of conversations about, because in the white imagination, racist does not mean someone who believes in white supremacy. Racist in the white imagination means a mean person. And everybody will tell you, "I'm not a mean person, so I'm not racist. I have black friends," and on and on and on. And so we need to do a lot of, I actually have my students write papers on the utility of calling people racist, because we're going to have to figure out other calling strategies to address white supremacy, as opposed to name calling. And there are things that are racist. You can name behaviors as racist, but naming people as racist is a totally different thing. And that doesn't mean that there aren't people who are in the white supremacist movement that I have a problem calling racist. But there are a much smaller percentage of the people who practice white privilege. And those are the ones that I don't find it useful to call them racist, because I want to have conversations with them, dialogue with them. And it's just basic human nature. Once you call me a name, why should I listen to you? That's just basic human nature. And so the whole concept of the artificiality of the construct of race and white supremacy, we need to have whole new conversations about. But I would also ask you to be patient with yourself, because you're just now learning to have this conversation. So don't assume. I can tell you're young, honey. Don't even try it. You're shaking your head at a 65-year-old woman. Huh? Yeah, but you're not as old as you think. That's what I'm saying. What I'm saying, okay? So we can learn. But see, learning how to do work against white supremacy is any skill set. Anybody can learn it. This is not magic. I'm teaching it every day. But it's something that you don't get just because of an identity. I had a young black girl in one of my classes say, "I don't need to learn about white supremacy. I've been black all my life." I said, "Well, hell, you could have been born and your parents put a violin in your crib. That don't make you qualified to play at Carnegie Hall." It takes work, skill, practice to become good at deconstructing white supremacy. Now, that doesn't mean everybody can't participate in it. I'm just saying, understand, sometimes you can only play "Mary Had a Little Lamb," and sometimes you're going to do virtuoso performances. It's a continuum. So I ask you to reinterrogate why you need to have that question answered, how useful it is for that question to be asked, which I think is very useful for it to be asked, and what does it mean for you when the answer may not be what you want to hear, that we have to intentionally work on racism and white supremacy, not ignore the categories that produce it.
Hi, I'm here to bring the microphone to my friend Dee.
I appreciate that. Hi, my legs don't feel so strong today. Thank you, I'm so appreciative to be here. I only heard about you recently by doing a workshop by an organizer in Maine family planning, and I loved it. And the reason I loved it because I've been saying those things in my advocacy work for years around women in poverty and homelessness. And then when the workshop came and we went through it, it was with women that were in recovery from sexploitation, rather was sex trafficking, or whatever name you want to call it, but it's being exploited and victimized through exchanging sex for money. And we did it together to come to the same result, and that it's very broad. It's not a specialty group. It's not if this person is this.
Do you have a question in there? Because
No, I didn't. I want to comment on the shift for me to go small and specific to broad as a human right, you know, and instead of this is all lacking in one race or one ism or one oppressed group. And I just appreciated it. And I'm appreciating sitting here.
So I can have a question. Do, though. My gosh, I think she's gorgeous. Thank you.
Hi, I was wondering if you could kind of give us some insight on how to approach or dismantle white liberal groups or kind of socialist groups that are whitewashing movements and whitewashing people of color movements that are in a way that is so inclusive and triggering to people of color. Sorry,
I don't have. No, it's a good question. I'm just trying to figure out how I want to parse it. Cause y'all pack a lot of stuff.
We dealt with some stuff like this, so I wanted some good insight on how to deal or better handle this.
Well, maybe I'll start this way. 53% of white women voted for Trump. We got that memo. There is a lot of ink being spilled on those 53%. What we have to do to deconstruct white supremacy is organize the 47% who didn't. Because it's going to take some white folks to deconstruct white supremacy. Okay? And what that's going to mean is that we're going to be working with 47% of the white female population as a feminist who hasn't had to have this conversation before, know something is wrong, come with white privilege so they think they should be in charge, even though they just learned the word. There's a whole lot of stuff. Trust me, if you're a good organizer, you will take all of that into your SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. That doesn't make them opponents, it makes them problematic allies. And you need to have a different strategy for a problematic ally than you have for an opponent. I have a different strategy for the 47% than I have for the 53%. Okay? And so there's that. Then I find that a lot of black people experience racism and don't know how to counter it. Like I said, it's one of those things you have to study. You have to do your homework. I was talking about how white parents keep their children racially innocent. I need to also bring my parents into the conversation. My parents thought that if they kept me sexually and racially unaware, that was the best way to send me off to college. No. I was like 8 years old before I heard the word nigger. And I had to run home and ask my mother what it meant. And she was like, where'd you hear that word? Da, da, da. I mean, the reaction was if I just said, fuck you. And she never explained it. She just wanted to know where I heard it, right? And so that's how we get raised. And now, you know, you have the talk about, you know, how to respond if a cop stops you and all of that, but you still don't understand racial politics and how to work across difference and how to deal with all of that stuff. So, same thing I'm telling that young man. Give yourself time to learn these things. Understanding that everybody is a problematic ally to you. Everybody, other black people would be problematic allies to you. And the reason I say that is because this is my favorite self-made cliche. When a lot of different people think a lot of different thoughts and they move in the same direction, that's a movement. But when a lot of different people think the same thoughts and they move in the same direction, that's a cult. And our job is to build a human rights movement. So we're going to be organizing with people who don't agree with us on a lot of stuff, but do basically agree with us that there needs to be a human rights movement. So that's going to require us developing the skills for handling white fragility, for not tone policing or holding back, but learning how to use what we have more effectively. My next book is called Calling In the Calling Out Culture, because I'm really tired of the way that the entire left is spending its best bullets on each other. When we got a fascist threat out here, you know? And we've taught that atomized way of social justice activism. We've taught all of y'all great theory and bad practice for building movement. And so that's why I'm trying to make an intervention with this Calling In book, so that we can learn ways of building that movement with people different, thinking different thoughts, but all moving in the same direction. And we have an example from our history. I mean, I'm part and parcel of the feminist movement, and there's as many feminisms as there are feminists. We don't all belong to the same organization. I know now, I wish we did. You know, they'd be a lot richer. But no, we don't all belong to the same organization. We all don't work against the patriarchy in the same way. We don't even have the same shared analysis of what equality means. But we all are dedicated to ending misogyny or misogynoir, you know, and so, and creating a better world for women. My boyfriend once asked me, why am I a feminist? And without a blink, I had to tell him, because I want better men. You know, that's really important to me. I was raised with a dad and five brothers. I want them to be better men. I love them, but there's some problematic assholes in my family. You know, and so don't assume that, you know, let me just say this too. Learning to work with others who are different from you requires forgiving yourself. If you can't forgive yourself for your mistakes, then you can't forgive others for theirs. So probably the most radical act of activism is self-love. I would actually say that. I didn't always get that memo, and I'm a bad practitioner of it. You can see how fat I am. But the reality is that I'm learning at the end of my career that the revolution starts within. And then you have an impact outside of yourself. And so accountability starts with love. Forgiving others start with love. Calling people in starts with love. You know, those kinds of things. I know that sounds like maybe not the answer you wanted to hear. I can cuss white people out with the best of them, but I say that for the ones that most deserve it.
Hey, Loretta Ross, how you doing?
Hi, how you doing?
Thank you for coming, super fan. My question is, how did you disarm and deprogram the racists?
The racists or the rapists? Because I've done both.
Yo, give me both. Okay.
Either one?
Yeah, both.
Well, when I was the director of the D.C. Rape Crisis Center, we were approached by black men who had been incarcerated for killing and raping women. And so we worked with them to start a group called Prisoners Against Rape, which I didn't think I would do because I was a rape survivor. And my first reaction was, we don't even have enough resources to help the victims, and the perpetrators are making demands on us. I mean, what kind of world is this? But even then, we had an intersectional analysis before the term had been created, and we knew that these were men from our community who would be returning to our community if they ever got released. And we wanted a different response to them than the prison industrial complex. And so it was scary, I'd never been in a prison before, so the whole strip search and all of the, you know, the dehumanizing practices just to walk in the door, I was not prepared for. But for 3 years, we ran Prisoners Against Rape and used Black feminist theory to teach these men how to be better men. Deprogramming white supremacists is a different project. It's not for the amateurs. I had to learn how to do it. First of all, I had to learn how to shift my perspective, because prior to me doing that work, I had not respected or seen the humanity of people in hate groups. I remember, unfortunately, telling a newspaper reporter one time that I compared the Klan to roaches. They only come out at night when you turn the lights out. You know, that's not how you should be describing human beings. But, you know, I was flipping it. I've always had a smart-ass mouth, and that was what I said, that I'm deeply ashamed of now. But deprogramming white supremacists, they did not have the same kind of moral epiphany that the rapists had. Most of the time when people are leaving hate groups is because they're trying to escape accountability for some criminal activity that they've got caught up in. And so they just want to run from it kind of thing. And when you hand in your resignation to a hate group, it's not like resigning from the Rotary Club, you know what I mean? Because you're leaving with a lot of knowledge of criminal activity that people will kill you for, you know, for having. And so what we had to do was set up kind of like an underground railroad witness protection program, but we couldn't use a normal witness protection program because these people weren't leaving the hate movement so that they could become an FBI informant. So the government wasn't offering them anything. You know, they just wanted to melt back into their life and be invisible again and not be found by their former brethren. And so once I started being engaged in this work and I started getting to know them, I was really disappointed to find out that I couldn't hate people that I'd gotten to know. Yeah? And then I was really pissed because if a Black girl can't hate the Klan, who is left to hate? I mean, my hate list is real short. Mean people. I'll keep mean people on it. And through that work, I found out that the greatest revolution was in my own soul. In order to fully see the humanity of people who didn't see mine. You know, because if they were prepared to wipe me off the face of the earth, I was prepared to do quid pro quo. You know, and turned out that that's not the way to build a human rights movement. And so I'm glad that I had people seasoned from the civil rights movement and from the early Black women's movement to help mentor me into a higher understanding of how to do social justice work in a way that honors the martyrs, doesn't dishonor them and stuff. So yeah, so deprogramming white supremacists, what we want to do basically is strip them of all their knowledge around the white supremacist activities. So I wasn't their first handler. A guy I worked with named Leonard Zeskin, he usually did the initial debriefing with them because he wanted to who you met with, where they meet, da-da-da. He would do like the professional deprogramming. My job came in when it was about reintegrating them back into society and stuff. So we would go on speaking tours together. We ended up on Jerry Springer once. That's not on the bio.
Is that on YouTube?
Huh?
Is that on YouTube?
It probably is. It probably is, because you know everything's on YouTube now. But organizing the religious left to support them, because that's where the churches came in to provide. Because usually when they leave with just the clothes on their back. They're like they're leaving a fire. Their house just burnt up. They don't get to neatly pack and move. You know, they leave in the middle of the night with just a coat on and a few precious belongings, and then they kind of slide into invisibility. And so we'd have to use the churches to provide that shelter, that sanctuary, for them to reinvent themselves. And again, because they don't have government support, it's very hard for them to reinvent, you know, identity documents and stuff like that. So, you know, it's a process.
Thank you.
Is that it? One more.
One more, if you don't mind. Thank you so much for coming. I'm really lucky to have seen you two of the three times you're here in Maine, so we're really happy to have you. And I'm going to combine some questions here so we get everyone's voices across. I was just sitting with some friends up in the balcony, and one of the things that kept bubbling up for us in our activism, you know, you talk about the human rights movement and all the different silos and the different ways that we're all working on these different things together, hopefully moving in the same direction. And our question was, and I think some of it has been answered in the other questions, but do you have any, you know, specific advice about tactics, strategies, policies, concrete actions and tools and ways we can work against the fascism in the Trump era, which I know is a very broad question. And the other question that we had was...
Can you hold that while I answer that one? Because
yes.
I won't be able to remember both questions.
Yeah, sure.
Since I've been doing this work for close to 50 years, I've seen what I call a lot of movement tourists. People come into social justice work, they stay a couple of years, then they become cynical, they burn out, they claim we're going to fail, and so they melt back into their lives and do what they need to do to take care of themselves. That's fine. I'm going to work on the assumption that you're representing people who want to hang in for the long haul. Not people who just come for a couple of years and do that. So my best advice to you is to party as hard as you work.
I think we do a pretty good job of that here.
Huh?
We do a pretty good job of that here in Maine.
Seriously?
Yeah.
No, but partying as activist practice.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not just being flippant here. I'm saying I don't know how it got dark. Was the devil talking to me? The devil's taking over. One of the things that's helped my sustainability as an activist is that I have a totally separate network of people who are socially important to me with whom I don't talk politics. Okay? We talk about everything else. Since I'm from Texas, it's often the Dallas Cowboys or... I play competitive pinochle, which is kind of like a bridge on steroids, you know. So at the same time I'm protesting something, they're doing yellow ribbon parties.
Mm-hmm.
So we're, you know, politically different places, but that's not why they're in my life. They're in my life to provide me with some balance of how the apolitical world operates.
Mm-hmm.
So that I'm not just having these circular conversations with only political people. Because that's where the burnout happens. And you become Debbie Downer.
Yeah.
You know? And it's not logical for someone to want to join a struggle that's going to make them feel worse off than when, before they came.
Yeah.
You know? And so when I talk about partying and having fun as political practice, I mean it. People have to feel joy being with us. Not depression. They can be depressed by themselves. They don't need our help. You know? And so we have to intentionally create ways of what did Tony Kaye call it? Making the revolution irresistible. Yeah. And one of the things I teach is about how you can repack a white identity with human rights instead of white supremacy. It's not about not being white, it's about being white appropriately, for example. You know, and the students seem to love that. Because they like to know that they don't have to have this bloody heirloom, that they can choose to be something else. You know, and I'm not talking about Rachel Dolezal choosing either. You know that unfortunate white woman that imagines she's black? I ain't talking about that. I want you to keep in mind the reality that you live in this world as a white person and use that differently.
Absolutely.
And so that's my sustainability recommendation. In terms of tactics, strategies, policies, it depends on what the situation is. But I can promise you that each of us could work on oppression in our own way and never run out of oppression. So nobody has to tell you, you must do this, or you must do this, or you must do that. Mm-hmm. That's bullshit. And like I said, that's amateur social justice work. Mm-hmm. Don't be an amateur.
Well, it's not the goal.
Huh?
That's not the goal. We're in it to win it.
Well, I think you can be a learner, because we're all learners.
Yeah.
Amateurs are the ones that pretend to be professionals and hate.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it shows, because they're in a woke competition. They trying to show how woke they are compared to how somebody else is. They're trying to show that they know the latest language for this, and you don't. And they're always trying to excise people out of the in-group of consciousness and stuff like that. They're policing boundaries. They're trying to define, you need to be a feminist this way, and you need to do this way. And I'm telling them, get over yourself. Because the more you're into that, the more you're exhibiting to a seasoned organizer like me that you're an amateur. And you may do more harm than good by being in the movement. I gave a speech earlier today on calling in the calling out culture. For those of us who had our activist chops developed in the 60s, we take call-outs very seriously because we lived through COINTELPRO, the counterintelligence program run by the FBI to destabilize radical groups. And so what I tend to think when I see someone so dedicated to being into the call-out culture, I don't see them as naive, I see them as possible plants.
Mm.
So unless you want everybody looking at you side-eye, wondering if you're there to disrupt us, you may want to check yourself on your call-out culture practices. Because I'm not going to assume that you just don't know any better. That's not a safe assumption for me to make.
Mm-hmm.
And stuff. So did you have a second question?
I did. My friend who was also online, she was asking if you could speak a little bit about Genevieve Vaughn, I think it was, your mentor. I'm sorry if I got the name wrong.
Who?
It was Genevieve Vaughn, wasn't it?
Tell me, I've had a million mentors. I was talking about Leonard Zeskin, who helped me deprogram white supremacists.
Okay.
I knew Ruth Sykes, who was an aide to Dorothy Height, founder of the National Council of Negro Women. It was white women, Nkechi Ture, who brought me to the Rape Crisis Center. I populate my conversation with people whose shoulders I stand on. I don't recognize that name. Oh, Genevieve Vaughn. I just had to situate you in context. You had it right. Genevieve Vaughn. Genevieve Vaughn, I met her. She was an extremely wealthy white woman who organized and funded us to do Central American solidarity work. And this was when the United States was prosecuting the war against Nicaragua, destabilizing Guatemala, El Salvador, stuff like this. Reagan was totally preoccupied with consolidating American control, U.S. control over Latin America. It was one of the things. And you all know about him trading cocaine for arms and introducing crack into American cities and all of that. That was all part of it. And so Jenny would organize exposure tours of activists to go to these countries, sometimes to throw our bodies in front of the tanks, kind of thing, like Tiananmen Square, because our U.S. money was funding this stuff. And so we thought that one way of being activists from the U.S. was to use our bodies to shield the people actually being under assault. And we knew that if one of us got attacked, it would be a different newspaper story than if an El Salvadorian died and stuff. So that was part of our activist practice. I spent a lot of time in war zones in the 80s, in the Philippines and Nicaragua, like I said. But Jenny was special because she was a woman of inherited wealth, and she decided to give away her entire fortune. And she wrote a book whose title I'm probably not going to get right, called The Giving Economy, which I have it on my shelf, but I haven't looked at it in a long time. But anyway, she thought that, she started with a platform of acknowledging human interdependence. And so she thought that we could turn away from plunder capitalism by embracing a giving economy, where we shared with each other freely, anonymously, and openly. And I find support for her point of view in the most unlikely places, in the Talmud, because a Jewish friend of mine once told me that it's very important in Judaism to understand that your neighbor's material needs are your spiritual needs. That you can't be right with God if you're ignoring the needs of your neighbors, of your community. So I think that's a very Talmudic saying that Jenny would have supported. She had that value system. And I think she eventually spent down her wealth. She said that when she got through, she was going to save just enough money to buy an Italian villa, so she did. And I haven't heard from her in years because I haven't been to Italy to find her and stuff. But that's a person who chose to handle their wealth in a different way. There's another group of extremely wealthy people called resource generation. And these are children who have inherited pretty massive fortunes who are trying to do social justice work with it. And so I love the fact that different people are trying different things. And like I said, we don't all have to do the same thing. I like the fact that there are philanthrocapitalists up against the Koch brothers. I mean, I don't agree with everything that Bill Gates is doing or George Soros or anything, but I'm so glad they're on our side as opposed to on the Koch brothers, Mercer brothers' side. And so I'm not going to get in a meeting with Bill Gates and start calling him out for what he's doing wrong. I'm going to call him in. By the way, did y'all enjoy that March 24 Parkland march that the kids did? That was the biggest march of love I've ever seen in Washington, D.C., and I've been to a lot of demonstrations in D.C. 800,000, maybe even a million people. The city was a city of love. I mean, people had big beaming smiles on their faces, spontaneous hugs. You would have think that somebody just giving everybody some good drugs. It was good to be in Washington on March 24th when those kids were protesting. And the reason that they come to mind right now is that unlike the women's Pink Pussy March, I don't know what else to call it. Y'all know what I'm talking about though, right? They didn't spurn the help of those that could help them professionally produce a march. And so there were jumbotrons for people to be able to see. There were crowd control people. There were people with clipboards taking names and numbers and stuff like that. There was orderly movement of the crowd. It was wonderful. And what that brings to mind is that it was the rich people who put their money in the infrastructure of the march and then let the 15 to 17 year olds control the content of the march that made it a sublime day, you know? And then what kind of disappointed me was that the march was on Saturday. I got back to class at Hampshire College on Monday. And I had just seen all these, like I said, 15 to 17 year olds, radical, intersectional, clear, beautiful. So I got back to class on Monday and I asked my class of 18 to 20 year olds, because I'm teaching a 100 level course, first years mostly, if any of them had done march activities the past Saturday. Class of 35 students, not one hand went up. I was like, wait a moment. And I said this, so, are you telling me that the 15 to 17 year olds are more radical than y'all are? I said, this is the consequences of me activism. Because y'all have belabored me learning what your fucking gender pronoun is. But when it's time for you to step out of that identity and be there for someone else, you chose to stay home. I have a problem with that. I have a problem with that. We got to do things better, people. Was that it? Thank y'all. Well, if you're purchasing books, I'll sit up here so I can autograph them for you.